30% of the district is brand new. There is no incumbent in 30% of the new district. Those folks especially have a right to have a choice, to have an opportunity. I am running for this district to bring a type of vibrancy to this district that is not there at this moment.
Hey, GRIO fam, I'm Gerren Keith Gaynor, Managing Editor of Politics and Washington Correspondent at theGrio, and I am here with Congressional Candidate Nina Turner, who is vying to represent the 11th District of Ohio, and we're just days away from the Democratic primary vote. Senator Turner, welcome to theGrio. It's a pleasure to have you.
Great to be with you, Gerren. I'm so excited.
So you're no stranger to politics. You are a state senator of Ohio. We know you as a TV pundit, as a surrogate for Bernie Sanders. And this is also not your first time running for the 11th district. Just last year, actually, in November, you were running for this same district. You did not come out victorious. Pundits have declared, or rather characterized, that contest, and they are still characterizing this contest as a referendum, if you will, on where Democratic voters lie, whether it is the establishment of the party or the progressive wing of the party. Is that how you view this race, and why did you decide to run again?
Not at all. And those who can, you know, try to just split it up that way, there is a lot of gray in this race and many contests across the country. This is really about the haves and the have-nots when it comes down to it, and who has the capacity and the courage to stand up for the poor, the working poor, and the barely middle class in this district and in this country, and not to sell out to the big moneyed interests that come swooping into a district like mine to try to dilute and pollute the voting power and prowess of the people who live, work, and play here. I decided to run again for this seat for the same reasons that motivated me to run in 2021 during the special election, and that is the people of this district actually deserve a fighter, someone that is not going to sell out to big money interests. My only interest are the people who are in this district, and especially those who are suffering the most under the weight of poverty. We know because of inflation and other compounding factors such as the pandemic, people who were already suffering before the pandemic and before the explosion of inflation due primarily to corporate greed are suffering even more so right now. And Cleveland itself is the poorest city of its size in the entire United States of America. One of every two children go to bed hungry at night, which means that their parents are probably going hungry at night as well. And we have to do something about it. And we cannot be ashamed or afraid to speak a certain truth to power and to push. And I am proud to say that I stand up and push the Democratic Party further than it ordinarily would go on behalf of the people who are suffering so much.
Your opponent is the incumbent Congresswoman Chantel Brown, who has served in office for less than 6 months. How would you assess her job performance? Why do you feel you are more suited to represent the 11th district over her? And what would you say to critics who might say that she has not served in Congress long enough to be primaried on her record?
Well, this is about a contest of ideas. This is America, the last time I checked. So to the critics out there, to anybody that would question why primaries happen, this is America. It is about representative democracy. And 30% of the district is brand new. There is no incumbent in 30% of the new district. Those folks especially have a right to have a choice, to have an opportunity. I am running for this district to bring a type of vibrancy to this district that is not there at this moment. And you know, on the Underground Railroad, Ohio, Cleveland, Ohio was known as the Station of Hope, and it was such for a reason. And so I am running to restore that hope. It causes me great pain and agony to know that babies are going to bed hungry, that their parents are probably going to bed hungry too, that people are fighting so hard to have a living wage, that healthcare, that is something that I hear on the trail all the time, is the need to be able to have universal healthcare. So it's not enough to just vote the right way or just sign off the check off the box so you can say that you did it. This is really about, the difference is really about who is willing to fight, who is willing to put something on the line for justice. And I have proven myself, extra special title or not, to be willing to do just that. And I believe that the people of the 11th Congressional District deserve that kind of representation. And lastly, I am not, you know, bought. I am not, you know, I come from the Congresswoman Shirley Chisholm school of the Democratic Party, unbought and unbossed. And over the last 2 weeks, and this should cause everybody pause, multi-billionaires and millionaires have poured millions of dollars into this race. We have an oil baroness who made a donation to the Democratic majority for Israel. They poured $1 million of that money into this particular race. We have a cryptocurrency billionaire who poured in $1 million of his dollars into this race. And there are other, countless other super PACs. The question becomes, why would people pour and invest that kind of money into this race, which is a solidly Democratic seat, if in fact they did not want something back for their investment? The people of the greater Cleveland area are going to lose if those people in fact win.
Democrats have touted the American Rescue Plan and the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act as key wins for America. President Biden, Vice President Harris, members of the administration have been traveling across the country promoting the investments of these legislation. Do you believe, because there is an expectation that Democrats will see a shellacking, if you will, by Republicans in November, do you believe that these bills are enough to run on and win in November?
Well, you are quoting the one and only President Barack Obama when you mentioned the shellacking, because that happened during a midterm election back in 2010. And here we are finding ourselves right back in that same situation, and it doesn't have to be so. Listen, the rescue plan, all of that was good. Very good. We should have done more of it. Getting shots in arms is a primary example that Democrats can, in fact, deliver to the American people in a time of crisis. So why not take that a step further and ensure that everybody has healthcare in the United States of America, a place where we are the only industrialized nation that does not have that? To answer your question more directly, the party cannot rest on the laurels of something that happened months ago, when the suffering of people right now in this moment is so immense because of inflation, because of unfettered greed at the hands of predatory capitalism. We know, for example, that the price of oil, even though the barrel of oil was not much higher than it was before, or, you know, the war on Ukraine at the hands of a ruthless dictator, we know that those oil companies, by way of example, increased the price of gas just because they could. And it is unchecked power. When you go to the grocery store and the cost of eggs or a gallon of milk is much higher than it was 6 to 8 months ago, that pain is being felt in real time. And my party has a magnificent opportunity to allay that suffering, to really change material conditions. We can do that by increasing the federal minimum wage. Why is it that everything else is going up but the minimum wage? We can do that by restoring the child tax credit, something else that, yes, Democrats can take great pride in having put forward a child tax credit by way of example, but we let it expire. And so the same children that were pulled out of poverty are now pushed back in poverty at the very moment that their parents and people in their community need this money to not even thrive at this point, to just be able to survive. And so the clock is ticking, but I do believe that with some more bold efforts, the president can sign an executive order by way of example to cancel student debt right now and help 45 million of our friends and their family members to be able to have more disposable income. That is an example of changing material conditions in real time. And I want my party to do that, because we know that Republicans have lost their ever-loving minds. They show that every single day on all levels of government. The Democrats can show that when they are in power, things do actually change in the lives of real people right now. That is what I want to see happen. That is what I want the administration to do and the Congress to do. And one more point, voting rights. What WTF? to push voting rights. It's not enough to say, oh, the House passed it and the Senate did not. When you are a leader, a particularly elected leader, and something is so fundamental as access to the ballot box and the right to vote, the John Lewis law should have passed the entire Congress, both houses, both chambers, right now. We got to stop playing games. Let's not play games with Manchin and Sinema, but there are other Democrats hiding behind Manchin and Sinema. There is so much more work that needs to be done. And one of my fears is that the people who live inside the bubble where life is mighty fine for them, they lose sight that there are millions of people in this country who are suffering every day, 140 million of people who are either living in deep poverty or one or two paychecks from being in poverty, that we can see promise in the problems that we are facing as a nation and as a society and provide some relief through public policy. Poverty is a policy choice and we can make new and different choices. That is why I'm running.
You mentioned two things that I planned on asking you, and I want to dig a little deeper. First, student loan debt cancellation. The movement to cancel is getting louder and louder. I'm in the White House press briefing room, it's asked about almost every single day. And recently, President Biden reportedly said to members of the Congressional Hispanic Caucus that the administration was exploring eliminating debt entirely. I'm not sure. We have not been able to confirm that. However, publicly, President Biden has said that the administration is open to canceling at least $10,000. But progressive members of the party, like Senators Elizabeth Warren, Bernie Sanders, and members, even members of the House, have been calling for at least $50,000 cancellation. And then there's also the issue of whether President Biden should do it unilaterally via the executive branch, or whether or not it should happen through Congress. The White House has consistently said that they would sign a bill that would be sent to them from Congress. Where do you stand in terms of the 10,000 versus 50,000, or should it be more? And should it be done through Congress, or should President Biden sign it, regardless of whether or not it may be a challenge in the courts?
Shout out to the Debt Collective and all the other activists who are out there pushing away every single extension of the moratorium that has happened in the Biden administration, has happened because of those grassroots activists. So I want to acknowledge that in this space. And then they have allies and co-conspirators like myself and so many others. The President of the United States of America has the authority to cancel student debt right now. And because of the recalcitrance of the GOP and the unsureness of certain Democrats, I think the President should take the power in his hands right now and go ahead and cancel that student debt. That same power that he has to place a moratorium is also the power that he has to cancel the student debt. Can you imagine the relief that 45 million people would have in that disposable income and what it would mean to them and their families? And there is a race component to canceling student debt because Black women carry the largest amount of student debt, the Black community, but Black women, even above that, carry the largest amount of student debt. The relief that he could provide in real time has both a class and a caste component to it. It would be a beautiful thing. And you want to talk about what would happen in the midterms? Don't you think that folks that got that relief would not walk, baby? They would run to go ahead and vote for Democrats because they're giving them something they can feel. There's a singing group that I love that is way before your time, but I think you've heard of them. And it's the women's group In Vogue. And there was a song they used to sing all the time, giving them something he can feel. And I changed the him to them, and the them meaning us, the people of this country, the people who need that relief. I mean, we bail out Wall Street all the time, but when it comes to putting a down payment on the hoods where people are misunderstood, whether it's the rural hood, the urban hood, or the suburban hood, why we gotta play games with it? The president should go head on and take a page out of the song, giving him something he can feel, giving them something they can feel, the people, so that they know that the love is real. Go ahead on, President Biden, do it, baby. Pick up that pen and sign an executive order and give people that relief. They need it. And why in the United States it should be unacceptable that just for the crime of going to college, you walk across a stage with a degree in one hand and debt in the other. It is untenable. It is not the way that it used to be, and it is not the way that it has to be in real time. Those are the kinds of things that I am fighting for and pushing for. So I want the president to pick up the pen and go ahead. Don't play with Congress. Just go and pick up the pen and sign that executive order right now. Give 45 million people some relief and some hope.
And lastly, on voting rights, You alluded to this earlier, but as you know, there have been a wave of restrictive bills being passed and proposed across the country in states that are controlled by Republicans. And there's also the issue of gerrymandering. There have been redistricting of maps. Even in your state of Ohio, there is the issue of redrawing the maps to give Republicans a huge advantage, and in some cases at the expense of Black and Brown voters, Black and Brown communities. When it comes to the issue of voting rights and passing legislative federal reform, obviously, as you mentioned, Democrats were unable to do that given the limitations of the filibuster and Senators Manchin and Sinema not being willing to change the filibuster rule to do that. Do you think that we're seeing the ramifications of not passing reform now in these states? Some maps are being challenged in the courts, even by the federal government. Do you think that this was miscalculated? And do you think that Democrats will rear the repercussions of this in November?
Absolutely, I do. And the great Dr. Maya Angelou once said something like this: if you know better, you got to do better. We saw this playbook back in 2010. Why are we repeating it? A couple of things on this, and I served in the Ohio Senate. I voted against the very last maps before, you know, this set of maps in my own state because of gerrymandering, because of the fact that the elected officials were determining who their voters would be instead of the other way around. As you know, as Congressman John Lewis once said, that the vote is precious, he said is sacred. And that remains true and will always remain true. And so we must protect it for all, not based on party line, just protect the vote. And this is where the extra shame on the Republican Party comes in, because they can't win with better ideas because they don't have them most of the time. So they gotta cheat. And so gerrymandering is happening all over this country. And part of the reason why it is happening is because of the failure of my party to act in the space between 2010 and the moment we are in right now in 2022. And while it is incredibly important to focus in on who's running for Congress in both chambers, and it is incredibly important to pay attention and fight for, you know, the presidency as well, what is equally important, and I'm not just saying this because I served in the Ohio Senate, I am saying this because of the very reasons that you brought up. They, Republicans, have the pen. We knew that 2022 was coming. We knew that 2020 was coming, another redistricting time. The Democratic Party must, and people who believe in representative democracy, these activist groups that are out there, we need a certain segment of people to focus in on state legislatures across this country, and also who's running for Secretary of State. That's one of the reasons why I ran for Secretary of State in 2014, because it is vitally important to have a fair arbiter that administrates expanding and protecting access to the ballot box. And here we find ourselves under the thumb of bodies, really, of Republicans who really just flat out don't care. And as you mentioned, even in my home state, about preserving the sanctity of the ballot box. So this fight must be had on the federal level, and it also has to be had on the state level of government too. And it hurts me to my core, because historically, when I think about, you know, how we got over, you know, there's a song in the African-American Christian tradition, "How I Got Over, My Soul Looks Back and Wonders." One of the ways that those whose skin has been kissed by the sun, to quote the great Zora Neale Hurston, talking about Black folks, one of the ways that we try to be able to control our own destiny is through the ballot box. It is the reason why historically white supremacists and a systemic failure has tried to keep us from our ability to vote. And so we see that repeat itself in the 21st century. And so we need people who are going to be vanguards of the absolute right to vote for Black people, for people of color, for poor people, for young people, for disabled people, for marginalized communities. Because any of the great and beautiful, magnificent thing that we want to have, we cannot have it unless people have unfettered access to the ballot box. And so I definitely, my message to my party is that we have got to pay attention to legislatures before it is too late, so that we at least get people elected who know that they should not play games with people's access to the ballot box. So it's all of those things. It's not just one thing. It is all of those things. Congress must act, and Democrats need to be out there talking about voting rights like our lives depend on it, because they do. The lives of people depend on it. This ain't partisan for me. This is about the people who need to have elected officials who actually care about them. We got to do that on the federal level, and we got to fight this good fight on state levels of government all over this country. And please don't forget about secretaries of state.
Any final words for the constituents of the 11th District of Ohio?
Oh, absolutely. It is so wonderful to join you. This is amazing. I hope to join you again. Look, Greater Cleveland is not for sale, and there's dark money pouring into this district by the millions of dollars. What I want to know, what I want the people who will have the opportunity to cast a ballot, that they have a decision to make, send a fighter or send somebody that has signaled that they are for sale. These multimillionaires and billionaires are not coming into this district for nothing. Imagine what we could do to lift the people of this district at $2 million instead of the ads that have been pouring in to really hurt and malign, not only me, but to hurt and taint the voices of the people who live, work, and play in this great district. We can send a message to the oligarchs of this nation that the Greater Cleveland area is not for sale, and that people power is going to have the final say. So please vote. Go to ninaturner.com, but vote Nina Turner, baby, if you can vote in the 11th Congressional District. And if you can't vote, your time, talent, and treasure, we can use that too. Go to ninaturner.com.
Nina Turner, thank you so much for your time.
We have way too much free content over here at theGrio. Stream a world with free entertainment, lifestyle, and news content. Celebrating Black excellence 24/7. Download theGrio now. It's free. theGrio.